Well, I'm not going to keep you so long this morning, and everyone said,
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We can gather here at the usual time. Praise God. For about 10 o'clock, hands up if you're looking forward to a cup of tea and coffee and juice. Yes, biscuits and tea. Well, praise the Lord. I'm looking forward to it as well, so I'm not going to keep myself. Only a fool would stand up here and keep preaching whenever he's the one that actually wants the coffee and the drinks and the tea, wouldn't he? So let's not be an idiot this morning, George, and let's just keep preaching in time this morning. But it is Pentecostal Sunday this morning, and we've been allowing the Holy Spirit to minister and to bless us. He's already doing that. You know, if we just went home now, we'd be so blessed with all that singing. Our socks would be just blessed off us, wouldn't it? And we go home and praise the Lord. What a great day we've already had this morning. But you know, there's a lot more that God wants to do for you this morning. So don't brush off yet. There's a lot more. And He wants to increase your faith this morning. You know, some of us, you know, may be getting told in one way or another that we're useless, we're worthless, there's no future for us, we're too old, too small, too tall, we're not educated enough, we're totally worthless, we're useless, we're ready for the scrap heap this morning. Yeah, but no matter where you are in life, your faith will get you a lot more further on. And so faith is really the key thing this morning. We have to increase our faith in order to allow the Holy Spirit to bless us, empower us, and to keep moving us forward. Everyone here, as Walton has already sung, can be a singer and a little preacher too. Yeah, you can do a little singing and a little preaching too. Everybody here, and it starts in your hometown. Yeah, your home place. So it starts by just sharing the gospel to people, telling people what God's done for you, how blessed you are, you've been to church, you've enjoyed yourself, everybody made you welcome, you've seen your friends, and you've come back empowered for the rest of the week. Now, it's up to you whether that only lasts on Monday or the end of today even. It's up to you. It's your choice. Will you have it Monday? Will you have it Tuesday? Hey, will you really step out of the boat, and will you actually have it by Wednesday? Can you still say, you know what, I'm a gospel preacher and singer, and I do a little preaching too? Can you do that for your neighbors, for your friends? Can you try and put one of those leaflets we've got through one letterbox? Because do you know what? Do you know when you put it through one letterbox, you'll feel like you're strong and confident. And you'll feel like, you know what, I could do another one of these suckers. Yeah, I could do another one and I can get it in another letterbox. And before you know it, you'll be down your street and you'll say, do you know what, it wasn't as hard as what I thought. Yeah, and that's the same thing all across your life, across your world. It's never as hard once you get moving and once you get going. So we need power of the Holy Spirit. We need God's wisdom to know the difference between what we should be doing and what we should not be doing. Wisdom is the principal thing. So we need God's wisdom. And of course we get that through the Bible. Say, Bible.
Bible.
Bible. Turn to your neighbor and go, Bible.
Bible.
Yeah, Bible. And John 14, verse 15 to 17, that should come up in just a second or two. Jesus said that He was going to send a comforter. Here's what Jesus said. And if you've got a Bible which highlights the words of Jesus, this would be in red, by the way. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever. The Spirit of truth, the world cannot accept Him because it neither sees Him nor knows Him, but you know Him, for He lives with you and will be with you. Yeah, He will be in you. So some people, some Christians think of the Holy Spirit as the power of God. That is true. The Holy Spirit is the power of God, but the Holy Spirit is also a person. He shall be with you. He will be with you and in you. It's not an it. So we believe in the Trinity, three persons. within the Godhead, they're all God. You can pray to the Holy Spirit, you can talk to the Holy Spirit, and He wants to be your friend. He's not just a power. Yeah. He's not just out there sort of like to boost your batteries, although He can do that, and He will do that, but He's a personal friend to you. And He's your friend and comforter, so that you can get through life through the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. So in order to become the person that God wants you to be, sometimes you've got to say no. Say no.
No.
Now, say it with attitude. Say it like,
no.
And say it like, no. Point your finger with attitude. No. Like, you're a naughty child. No. Right? Because some of us as Christians, we can't say no very well. And the Holy Spirit will give us the power to be able to say no to the things that are bringing us down. One of the questions you should be asking yourself is, whenever you do something or go somewhere or want to spend something, is this the wise thing to do? Is it the wise thing to do? You know, according to who I am, my past and my failures, is this the wise thing to do? And a lot of times the Holy Spirit will tell you no. And He'll stop you doing stuff that's destructive and going to destroy your life. You know, we all need boundaries in life. The Holy Spirit will help us set the boundaries, the limits. You know, we've got property here as a church. I live next door in the manse, and it's all part of this property. But you know, I'm responsible for what's inside that property. I'm not responsible for doing my neighbor's hedge down the road or cutting a tree down next door to the property. So I have to work, and I am responsible within the boundaries of that property. Yeah, and it's the same in every walk of life. You know, if you watch a football match, there's lines, there's a referee blowing his whistles if the balls go out of boundary or crosses the line. You know, and when I was thinking of this here, I was thinking of John McEnroe, yeah, the tennis player. Yeah, what would happen if there was no chalk dust? Yeah, I seen chalk dust. Yeah, the ball was in if you seen the chalk dust with John McEnroe. That was great fun watching him. And he was a great believer in boundaries and whether the ball was out or whether the ball was in. But what we don't want to do is become a Mrs. Can-Do-It-All. Have you ever been around churches and you get a Miss or a Mister and they can do it all? And they do everything and everyone loves them, the pastor loves them, and at work he does everything, and at work they all love him and everyone just loves him, except when you ask his family sometimes. This is sad. Because sometimes they neglect their wives, they neglect their children. And some children have grown up and they only wish that their dad or their mom even was there and wasn't too busy all of the time, because they missed lots of stuff that they should have been there for and they weren't. And so the Holy Spirit will help you to have unique boundaries. The Holy Spirit wants you to have a strong family, a good family, as well as to help other people. So the Holy Spirit will really empower you to help you to get the balance for those boundaries in your life. And in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, and walk with the wise, and you will become wise. For a companion of fools suffers harm. Yeah? Am I right there? Yeah, 20. It's not quite rough, but maybe it's the next one on that. That is one for, it's the one before that, but it's okay. I've got them in the wrong order, actually. Can you go to Proverbs 4, verse 23? It should be there, yeah. That was it just a second ago. Yeah. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. So if you've got to guard your heart, yeah, and this is the wisdom of God speaking into your life, then you need boundaries in order to guard your heart. You need boundaries. Say boundaries. That's what you need to guard your heart. Now, there's nothing more serious the knock-off boundaries whenever you come into contact with people and you make friends with people. When we make friends with people, we do need boundaries. Say friendship. Turn to your neighbor and say, I accept you. And then say to your neighbor, you're my friend. Companion. See, there's nothing better in church than having friends in church and being accepted. Now, even though Jesus accepted everybody he came into contact with, yet he didn't do what they were doing. He got blamed in places that he was doing what they were doing, but he wasn't doing what they were doing. He was still a friend and a companion. And sometimes in my life, I don't know if it's the same with you, but we get involved with friends and we feel pressure. We want to go where they want to go. We want to do what they want to do. You know, and sometimes we've got to act. It's like we're different people. Whenever we're not the real us when we're with those people. And I've been like that, and that's why I know those people weren't for me and for my future. You don't need to pretend if you've got real friends. Real friends will accept you just the way you are. And so Proverbs 13, verse 20. We'll have a look at that now. It says, walk with the wise and become wise. Say wise. For a companion of fools, say fools, will suffer harm. Turn to your neighbor and say, stop being a dummy. Because, you know, if you're walking with fools, you're being a bit of a dummy, right? You're being deceived. You are being deceived if you're walking with a fool. And you know the thing about being deceived? You don't know you're being deceived because you're being deceived. Yeah, you get it? So you don't know. And then you get pressured to compromise, to be with the fools and to be just like them. God wants you to be wise. And to be wise here in the church, wise about everything you do, with your family, with your friends, with your finances, even with your health. Yeah, be wise with your health. Yeah, because a fool is somebody who knows what to do. And we all do this. I'm preaching to myself now as well, by the way. We know what to do, but we don't do it. And we compromise it. That's a fool. That's a foolish thing to do. So God wants us to be wise. And to look at the consequences. Here's a question you can ask. What is the outcome? Simple question. If I keep doing this, and I live this way, and I say these things, and I listen to those things, and I watch those things, and I go to these places, what is the outcome of a life like that? And Proverbs 1, verse 32. Proverbs 1, verse 32, it says, for the waywardness of the simple, say simple, will kill them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. Jesus said the thief comes to rob, steal, destroy, and to kill. Right? How does he do that? He doesn't just turn up, yeah, and shoot you, or turn up with his pitchfork, or turn up with a knife. It's usually more subtle than that. He does it through your friendships. He does it through your people, and they get you wayward. And they get you off track. And then eventually, it starts nice maybe, but eventually further down the road, they'll say to you, lighten up a bit. Come on, let's go, party time. You know, relax a little bit. And before you know it, bit by bit, you start to lose everything that you've built up all your life. There's many stories in the Bible that speak about this truth, the sowing and reaping and the consequences of your actions. So the Holy Spirit this morning is here to empower you and to set you free and to help you to make wise choices and to have a balanced life within your life. His plans are for good for your life. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 33 to 34 says, do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good character, Come back to your senses, say senses, as you walk and stop sinning. For there are some who are ignorant of God. I say this to your shame. Right? People are ignorant that God's Holy Spirit is powerful, wants you to have good company. Don't be influenced negatively by bad company. Right? So you can be with them. Yeah, if you're strong enough to be with them, but don't let their bad company bring you down. Don't let them influence your life so you go off track and you go wayward. Stay on God's track. Stay positive. Don't be afraid to say no to people and rely on God's Holy Spirit to show you how to live a powerful life. So that when people come into this church, you are the people that's going to be setting them free through the power of the Holy Spirit in you. So it's really important for you to get this. And when you get it and you start to succeed, you become more happy, you become more joyful, you get more things in life, you're more in control, and you're saying to God, should I do this, should I do that? And it becomes like second nature as a Christian, and you just get inspired to do things, and some other things you're not so inspired to do. But you cannot be a Mrs. and a Mr. can do it all for everybody. It will ruin your life. You'll be drained. Yeah? There's leeches who'll suck the blood right out of you until you've no energy left. So you really need the wisdom of God through the power of the Holy Spirit this morning to know the difference and to know what God wants within your life. You're still here?
Yes.
Oh, good. Yeah. You know, God's got a plan for your life. Yeah? And God says that you're worth it. We've already said it this morning that he's going to die in your place. Jesus died in your place because you are worth it. Now, in today's world, when we talk about worth, some people say, well, I'm worth the amount of money that I've got in the bank, which might be a great deal of money, or I'm worth the amount of cars, or the amount of possessions, or my house, and what I own. But we're not interested, to be fair. That isn't the first priority in your life. That isn't your worth. That might be your net worth in this world, but it's not the net worth and the gross worth according to Jesus Christ and the eternal world. Your net worth is your soul. It's who you are. It's you as a person without all the trappings. It's who you are. You are worth it. You are valuable to God. Each person is worth it. Jesus said that he is with you until the end of the age. He wants to be your friend. Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. You can go out of this building this morning. You can have a friend for life. You can have a guide in the Holy Spirit. You can have the power of God to help you to live a successful life. It's still hard. You've still got to make choices. You're not a robot. You've got to make good choices. Yeah, so that's the hard bit. But the easy bit is that if you make the right choices, God's power will empower you to bring you further in life and to get you where you want to be. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. I know we know this off by heart, most of us. For I know the plans. Say plans. I offer you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper. Say prosper. Prosper you. And not to harm you. Plans to give you hope. Say hope. And a
future.
This morning, that's what Pentecost Sunday is all about this morning. God has a plan to give you hope and a future this morning. Going to just bow our heads here just for a minute, and we're just going to ask God to reveal to us his plans and his future. And I'm just going to pray with you in a minute or two for God to really bless you and to empower you. Now, if you're here this morning and you think to yourself, do you know what? I've never had the plan of God in my life. I've never had this future that God has for me. If you're here this morning and you're thinking to yourself, I receive you this morning. I want that plan. Then all you need to do, so I can pray with you and fellowship as a church is, if you don't mind, if you just raise your hand and I'll see it, and then I'll know, yes, there's somebody here this morning that wants God's plan and God's future in their life. Nobody else can see it. And if you raise your hand, then if you raise your hand, I'll be able to pray with you, we'll be able to bless you, and we'll be able to help you on that journey, the start of the journey. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Lord. See that hand. Yes, praise God. Thank you. Thank you, see that hand. Thank you. Praise the Lord this morning. So this morning, thank you for those couple of people that's responded this morning. We're going to pray. I'm going to say a prayer. I want those people who have raised their hands to really say this prayer. This could be the turning point in your life. This is why we do church. It's for you. It's for other people here. This is why we do church. So just say this prayer after me. And if everybody says it, then that will encourage the people who have raised their hand this morning. Lord Jesus Christ, I thank you for the plan that you have for me. Lord, forgive me of all my sins. Pour out your Holy Spirit in my heart. I accept your forgiveness. I'm not going to do the things I used to do. I'm going to do the things that you show me. Help me to be obedient. And help me to be a preacher of your word. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now, if you said that prayer, and that'd be really good. If you said it this morning, it's a new life, a new beginning, and it's up to you. You can say other prayers later today, and it's up to you to walk and to be obedient, and then to have the life that God has for you. But I praise the Lord for those couple of people, and we'll be chatting with you a bit later and praying with you. And tell people about it, say hello to people, and just bless people.